How are you doing?
I can kill you with a piece of paper.
It is on the last.
Old days, plus three.
Oh, no.
This. Look at what it says.
Ready to read your last name? At Purple Penguin? It should come through now. I just sent it. No? Got it?
Yeah, open up a lot.
Yeah, I
Get it all the way.
Help.
Yeah.
Well, it's. Good.
Okay. Do you have any? Yeah.
Yeah, you can also just like. Basically, what the story was. Exactly. I need to get that one.
Yes.
I would have worked it out.
Hey. Well, it's like off the edge, but it's got a very nice one. Once I could say.
What I wanted. I just want to check out that box.
Seems like I could see long.
So yeah, they might be double.
Yeah, definitely. I have to do it myself, but I mean, cool, I got. Yeah, I'm just not that big. It's on the first group for somebody successful.
Just go for myself, I'm definitely gonna do it.
Yeah.
So what do you want to say?
Yeah.
I'm thinking about doing that.
I love it, yeah. But they want to buy.
I said, here you go.
I did a great, that's what you have.
That I would.
Oh, you're like, oh, my, you're talking actually. Not about what you say. It's hard. Definitely.
We still have a back end. It's a court.
I mean, I do.
Literally, I used to have some. Then someone at the court, they see all the stats.
But the one you get monthly. I think that.
And that's how I'll make it be a place.
Maybe the first time I'm running, I definitely. My whole.
Of course. I don't know. I was.
You're in it. Can I take a peek at this?
All right, so everybody checked in. Dude, somebody like, oh, I still forgot to check.
The reminder helps.
Really? You got a reminder. Come on.
Well, good. Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it.
No. What? Da-da-da-da-da.
All right, everybody, let's get started. Welcome to another episode of Create TV Edition, the individual presentation edition. Everybody excited for today?
No.
Who just can't wait to get up and do this? And who wishes this day would never come?
Me too.
Excellent. I thought that's right. Well, there's a lot of opportunity today. We're gonna have some fun. Right? I wish I could make sure that we set you up for success in this class. So to that end, I have a great expense. It drinks a lot of Starbucks. Ray Jasmine, dear friend of Paul's, is our class today. And Ray is going to help you prepare for your presentation. Ray does quite a lot of media training, a lot of entrepreneurs, and he goes. I've known Ray for probably about 10 years or so, and we have worked on quite a number of different things together. So Ray is going to help you, before you get up into your presentation, just think about what you're going to get up there and actually do. Right? So that number to jump into individual presentations. That will probably fill up most of the time after the class. Right? Does anybody have any problems after I correct the blackboard about turning in your amendments? Any issues?
I have an issue.
basically my documents were not displayed right, but I sent it to by via email.
It wouldn't come documents.
My memo had some attachment, which is some graphics.
It's all day.
Yeah.
Right. You just got it in?
Yes.
Very good. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, so. So some other things too, right? So most of the time, make sure we set you up for success and give you some tips for today. I also want to turn up the heat a little bit, right? So as we have discussed, we will be very critical of your presentation, your concept, give you positive feedback on everything. We also will be live streaming this. So if there's any, for any reason that you your genius idea shared, that's okay. Just let me know, man. You want to save your IP. Your lawyer hasn't got back to you yet without protecting it, and you want to hold off, and then we'll pop the camera off and you can view it after that, right? The first part of this stuff is going to be a bit of a live stream.
So, you guys do much? Anybody play Google Hangouts, live stream much? Anyone?
Sometimes.
Right. So, so I like to demystify the, you know, the technology. Quite a bit, right? So simple USB camera. It's a Logitech C920. You get it for like $90 at anywhere, and then just a little stand, right? And then I run a USB extension off of this thing because that way you can kind of get around and you can do a bit of a shoot, right? So what I want to really do is capture kind of your presentation. So you get that, you get a little camera room, right? A little thrill cam, a little what's up?
What's up?
Right? And then it's just running into my Mac, and then on a wireless connection going out to, although I guess I could pop in that Ethernet. That probably helped that thing out a little bit. And then just out into Google Hangout through my YouTube channel. So I threw a couple graphics set up both on the sides, right? That's what I see. So we use this for a lot of different types of things with clients, and it's just not that complicated.
Is there a way for us to know if anybody's actually watching this?
Yeah, right. So we get something on here. I'll tell you people like on the bottom says number of viewers. So we'll see. So I threw this out on some Facebook pages. I threw it out on my Twitter thing. Tag SDSU and SDSU College of Business. Hashtag creativity. Hashtag innovation. Hashtag MGT353. You know, whatever. So have a little fun with this thing, man. Like, you're sitting on your device anyway. You want to throw some stuff around? Throw some purposeful stuff around. Right, I like to show off what we do in class a little bit, like that, a little fun, like brag about my students. So we'll get this stuff set up
in here and have a little fun with that. Yes. Now you're internet famous. You can break the internet with your genius idea.
Okay? Any other questions about what we got going on? This is a fun class now. Right? We have fun with this. Right? It's like art meets recess meets Starbucks. Stuff, right? So without further ado, I would like to introduce my friend, my colleague, my bestest buddy, Mr. Ray Drasnin. Please give your hands, slap them together.
All right, my name is Ray Drasnin. I am the founder and CEO of Drasnin Consulting. I'm a publicist for celebs and NFL players since my time in LA. Time like prison in LA, but no one trains you how to play in a huge media market like Los Angeles. It's very fast paced. It's the second biggest media market in the nation. We are the seventh largest city, San Diego. Guess what media market we are?
Number one.
And here's the reason. Just beneath us is a whole different country, right? To the west is an ocean, to the east is Billy Joe Jimbach. That's all you have. There's nothing here, right? So we're a small media market. Look at the evening news tonight here, and then try and grab KTLA out of Los Angeles, even though it's a poor station by LA standards. The type of business is different. So here's what I do for my clients. I teach them how to be good when the camera comes on. Do you know, out of however many people are here, your greatest fear is tonight? And so don't believe in that. Just don't believe it. Oh, what's everyone's the most uptight about? What are they most uptight about? They're most uptight about getting their face in front of a group of people and making eye contact and hoping that the heads start going up and down, which means you own your audience. But as soon as you do it, there's this insane power to it, and then you start loving it. So if you believe you're going to be good, self-fulfilling prophecy, I'm good, guess what? You're going to be good. So here's media training. This is the most simple, over-the-top version of media training. look at the evening news. The people that you think are most compelling, whether it's reality TV or whether it is a presidential candidate, are people that speak in 7 to 11 words. You know, I think you can have Trumpisms. I think my wife would be the best looking, you know, first lady ever. That means nothing, but that's the way he speaks, right? So if it becomes memorable at all, someone regurgitates it to mass media. You look at the mass media, either online or on television or in a paper, and guess what? You start saying it. So media training is powerful. It will help you, one, overcome this fear, and two, it will make you feel insanely good when the camera comes on. So here's what you have to do. You have to think like the media. You think you sound like. Again, 7 to 11 words, and what that means is it doesn't matter what the question is. If you look at a politician, it matters not at all what the question is. His answer is going to be, I'm awfully proud of the program we've put out here and the great work I've done in, as say, right, Ohio or Vermont, whatever candidate you like. And that's his answer to it. Same thing with your product. So when you get up here, you've been tasked with creating a product or service. What do you have to do? You have to make it good. You have to make it compelling. You have to determine who the target audience was and how you would talk to them. What if you have different target audiences? What if it is a laptop case? You can give me aging baby boomers. You can give me millennials. You can give me anyone that you know is part of the psychographic and demographic that would buy that. So when you get up here, guys, own my ass. And you know how you do it? Own me from the very beginning. If you don't like my headline, old school, right? You'll never get me to the first paragraph. And if you don't like my first paragraph, I bore the piss out of you and you'll never read the rest of it. So something I've been doing for 30 years, being a PR guy, totally changed. I work with a 20-year-old who goes to San Diego State. And you know what she said 2 months ago? I didn't believe her. I'm in my 50s and she's only 20. We should never write a press release again. And I said, obviously you have better drugs than I do because press releases I mean, she brings them, and so I give her better breaks now. And so press releases are old school. It's not a reality. Because the world is more ADD and OCD than me. Everyone's got no time. The media has no money, so they're not going to take any time because they don't pay the people any money to read your crap. So my entire world is an email pitch now. So embed some video. Tell me you have a cute kid, or tell me you have an aging person, or tell me you have a wonderful product, right? Own my ass tonight, and you'll own me. Right, so think about your audience. You only have a couple of people that are grading, so I would look at that psychographic and demographic. But no, you should also own them. Because if everyone's head starts going like this, you know what they say about a great psychiatrist? When a good-looking woman comes into the room, he's the only one that looks at everyone else. Right? So if all of a sudden Kevin and I are taking a look and grading the presentations on some fun level, if you are engaged, if you own your other students, it'll work out great. Hey, here's media training. Really super fun.
Do you have your video? You want your video?
Oh, here's a fun piece. Okay, but this is the difference. This is a YouTube of why late in life with goofy little twins, when I actually had a disposable income, a bank account, and everything. God only knows why. Late in life with twins, I wanted to change the type of people I did business with. So take a look at a TED Talk I did. And it shows how no matter what skills you get in school, and the speech that I do for every university in this city is what they never taught you in school. This is what they never taught you in school. Take a look what it looks like with NFL players.
My name is Ray Bradman. I'm a publicist, a PR guy. And I'm going to talk to you about right and wrong. And believe it or not, I'm going to do that in less than 7 minutes. I cut my teeth in Los Angeles. And when I was there, I would deal with celebrities. Arrogant, pompous, aloof, condescending, entitled Hollywood celebrities. And NFL heroes. Let me tell you what that really looks like. 2 a.m. one morning, I get a call. It's one of the NFL heroes, and he is appalled. He's whining because he just got pulled over for driving while under the influence with a 17-year-old prostitute, and his Bentley has been impounded. No big deal for me, just another day at the office. Nothing but crisis communications. So here's what that looks like in my world. By 7 a.m. the next morning, I have our NFL hero at a pediatric oncology ward signing footballs for children. I made that guy a hero before the bad news caught up with him. Next up, international financial institution. And you all know the names of these people and these places, but I'm not going to say it. They're getting ready to fire 5,000 people. But before those 5,000 people lose their job, it's my job, and I do it, to put the CEO on the front page of the New York Times business section, and his tie is pulled down. He's just a regular Joe. What I did in those days was make really good stories about really bad situations. Was the money good? You betcha. Okay, fast forward a few years. Me and my son watching the NFL on a Sunday. A lot of those same moralistically challenged athletes on the field. A lot of those same soulless corporate sponsors on the Jumbotron. And what I realized in that moment, my epiphany, my big aha, is that things hadn't really changed much, and I hadn't done anything really important or powerful to help them change. So what could I do? What could I do to right a wrong? Well, what I really wanted to do was to be able to go to bed and put my head down on the pillow and have my wife put her head on the pillow and have my kids put their heads on the pillow and think that I had made the world a little bit better. But in fact, that wasn't a reality. So I needed some help. So it may have taken Moses 10 commandments. It may take Letterman 10 top 10s, but it took me only 5. And so what I created was brand new rules of engagement. And here's what those rules of engagement are. Number one, be selective about those people with whom you do business, right? So let's say you're in a service industry, lots of us are. Instead of the client choosing you, right, do you expect them to walk up to the front door and give you a big old check and say, you're my agency? No, I say, and I believe this is an incredibly cool and impactful, powerful way to do new business, you choose them. Right? Here's an opportunity for you to decide who you want to do business with. And if in fact you do that, that gives you the power. That's number one. Number two, not only is it you that goes out and takes a look at them, but it's you that takes a look at them before you ever meet them. It's called research. We're in the information age. If you sit down in a new business opportunity and you don't know everything about everyone that's sitting in that room, something's wrong. So even though you may find something you don't necessarily want to find out about that person or that company, why wouldn't you want to know it? Number three, one of my very favorites. We've all had bad clients. What do you do? Fire them. It's cathartic. It is incredible. It is the hugest weight off your shoulder. I did it just a month ago. What am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to go home to those little kids who said I wanted to put on the pillow and make sure the world was a better place? If I'm doing business with someone and I preach to them about morals and values and ethics, and the person that's paying me doesn't care about any of that, well, that's just wrong. Number four of the new rules of engagement. Number four is get in touch with your gut. Right? In your 20s, you kind of have these inklings, you have these feelings, you know, the good guys and the bad guys. In your 30s, that gut starts to get more finely tuned. You know never to do business with attorneys. No, that's not true. In your 30s, that cut gets more finely tuned. In your 40s, you get this extraordinary power, and it's called understanding body language, right? So in the boardroom or in any business scenario, that person who's standing back like this, you know exactly what he or she is saying. And it's a huge tool. It's an incredible asset. So those are the brand new rules of engagement that I began to employ. Here's what I really wanted. I wanted to make a difference, and I realized that until I started changing the way I looked at doing business, it couldn't happen. So what do I do now? I still work for athletes, but I work for the good guys. I work for the guys that have great foundations. I work for the guys that instead of me having to tell them what their foundation is going to be about, they already know. Think Peyton Manning, not my client, but there's a guy that gets it, right? He may not be able to get his way through the playoffs, but he gets it. There are some incredibly good guys out there. I work for the nonprofits. They don't understand business usually very well. And so I teach them how to get to the promised land. Even when I work for the for-profits, I demand that they have some level of philanthropic outreach. So what I learned was I can make anyone a hero, right? I was making bad guys heroes. I was taking the guy who just got busted in the Bentley with the you-know-whom and all the rest of it, and I made him look good the next day. I didn't want to do it anymore. So now if I could pick the guys that I wanted to work with, if I could do the research with the companies I wanted to work with, if I could work with the nonprofits and then take the for-profits and talk to everyone, from the CEO to the custodian, and say, what are the things that turn you on? Is it breast cancer? Is it race for the cure? Is it chemotherapy? Who knows what it is, but there's something out there that touched them. And if I could get that entire company en masse as one to find a cause that turned them on, guess what? I could get them engaged. So what do I do these days? I play with the guys that make me feel good. The publicist who had the power of the press. I didn't want to do it anymore unless it felt right. So now when I go home and I talk to my kids, 9.5-year-old twins about morals and values and ethics, and they pay no attention because their head is in their iPad, I share with them values that I live, right? So talking it is one thing, walking it is another. So the name of the speech is a change of heart. And here's what I propose. I think we made this world, right? I can make the evening news to a certain extent. Manipulate's not a nice word. You try and create media. But the fact is there are publicists behind the scenes that make the news every single evening. You think a camera crew just happens to stop by a scenario? It doesn't work like that. There are publicists behind the scenes that create the wow factor, and that wow factor has a big appeal for a camera crew, and the camera crew is called, and the camera crew goes out, and that's the evening news. That is powerful. So are you going to do it for the good guys, or are you going to do it for the bad guys? I had to change of heart. I didn't want to go home to my kids and feel awkward. And so I took that amazing opportunity for mass media to say something good. Are we tired of Malaysia, Aaron? It doesn't mean it wasn't a tragedy. It doesn't mean 300 and some odd people, still we don't know what's transpired. What it means is that there are good stories out there. There are better stories out there. And the media loves them. The media wants to tell those stories. So here's what I propose to you. If we can make a change, and if we can do business with better folks, and if we can create better stories, I think each one of us, right, how you eat an elephant one fork full at a time, can make the world a little bit better place. And if we each do that, I think in a big way, we impact what our heads do on the pillow at the end of the night. We made our kids better. If we make our kids better, we influence another generation. If we influence another generation, we get good stories on the tube, all of a sudden, a lot of those incredible stories, like that young lady Breezy, become a reality because the media tells it. So here's what I ask you tonight. What are you going to do to make the world better? What are you going to do to change the world? And I don't think it's that hard. I think that each one of us has an opportunity to make a difference, and I'm saying I did it, it feels great, and I hope each one of you can as well. Thanks for your time.
Yay, Ray!
Okay, so that's what the heck I figured out 9 minutes later. But here's what you need to do today. Only when you come over here. So say, I've got a product, and then tell me how you got to it. I've got a product that I created because I knew there was, and then give me your void in the marketplace. I knew people wanted more blah, 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 and they didn't have access to it. I knew people wanted a faster car that didn't use gasoline, right? Boom. Tesla said that at some point, right? Some guy came up here in some room and said, here's this vision. Own me when you come out and speak in short sentences. There were times that you could see, I said, oh, I've got five new methodologies of addressing the real world. Guess what? I only put four out there. But you could see when I paused, instead of saying, and looking like an idiot, here's the trick. You pause, furrow your brow. I can't because I need Botox to furrow your brow. You look down, and then when you look up and hit the camera, bam, they think you're smart as hell. Oh, he was really thinking about it. She was really thinking about it. I can tell it's from the heart. So these are tricks of the trade. Remember I talked about body language? None of this, man. There's none of that. People that want to share their chest are over the table. So when you come here, there was an old, it was Kennedy and Nixon, and people that listened to that debate back in 1960 thought Nixon was better. People that watched it thought Kennedy was. He was pretty. He knew how to hit his mark. He came up. Same thing with Clinton. Watch the great ones. In a debate, they'll get away from the microphone and the podium, and they'll come and they'll give you eye contact and they'll do some gesture. So do that, right? So think about it as a game. And here's what I do. I pitch media all day long. I pitch the mirror until I believe myself. When I really believe myself, boom, I'm home. You know, there is a madness to the method. So again, tell me why you did it. Share what inspired you. If you give me an anecdotal story, gee, when I was little, my mom always said you have to make your bed. So I came up with this really cool invention that fluffs pillows and makes that. Who knows? You know what you come up with. But those stories make you a more compelling speaker. You know what I mean? Because now it's about you. So if you can think quickly before you even said today, or you're not number one, put some element like that into it. Tell me why it's going to be special. And then pay it off without sounding like an egocentric idiot. Hey, man, this is a product that's been coming for a long time, and I'm awfully proud to put it out here. And I think all of us, students at the university level, can employ it, and it'll make us better students. Boom. Who cares if I believe that? But if you're strong and you own me and you've got eye contact, you're going to make points. So again, it's being on stage, you know, it's going all out, right? If you come in and you...
He always does it like that.
That's right. That's a very good look, I'd like to point out.
Does anybody have any questions of Ray?
Nope.
Yeah, your media consultant.
Yeah.
Was your presentation somewhat related to Ryan Hawley's book, Just Count the
Money? These are my experiences. These are NFLers that would come to me and wouldn't even know what the heck their cause was. Tito Ortiz at the end. MLB. And then I help people with foundations, Deerdick and these two shoes. These are guys that do have passion, and you should have seen Deerdick. I couldn't even understand Deerdick. I'm in my 40s, Deerdick is like 20, he's hanging at DC Shoes, and he says, Ray, I'm going to have an MTV show. It's going to be called Me and Big Black. I go, she can't have an MTV show called Me and Big Black. And of course, he did. You know, and four other ones, but you're supposed to have fun with it. So instead of feeling, oh God, what am I going to present? Give it to me, man. Just put it out there, right? Lay it on the line and own it. And don't you dare do this. And don't do word for word, right? Encapsulate it. Look down. Remember the furrowed brow, the pensive. Boom. Come hit your audience. And then own me at the end, too. So there you have it. Right? Encapsulate it real quick. It's a great product. We've designed it for a very specific target audience. We think we have our messages on key, and we believe we could get funded. Boom, if you tell me that, yeah, my vote. There you have it.
Other questions? Are you?
Oh,
yeah. Just how did you come up with all this doing this? I mean, actually making it a business.
I'm in the image business. On the brochure of one of my companies, Drazen Communications, it said image is everything. So CEOs, long after you come up with this product, you may end up taking this to market, who the heck knows? Long after, there's going to be another product. And so you have to brand yourself, right? It wasn't about Chrysler back in the day, it was about Iacocca. It's not necessarily just about the company, oftentimes it's about the CEO. So you want the CEO to look great. You know, back in the day, I did it for the bad guys. That big ass company was American Express, and they did lay off 5,000 people. And I made the guy look perfect on, you know, the cover of the New York Times. So there's a market for everything. So if you tell me, right, that you know your market today, I'm going to believe you. There's a market for everything. So why should I just charge blank $1,000 a month from a company when I can make money on media training? And if they get in trouble, they're a restaurant, and they put salmonella in swordfish of a little kid who goes to eat at the Brigantine restaurant, boom, your ass is in trouble. You got to get out of it. Oh, there's another $10,000 for me. That's called crisis communications. What are you going to do? Who would talk about it? What if the CEO were out of town? Would you brand an interview with one person that's already kissed you about the media and said, you know, you have a good relationship? Would you do a press conference? Yeah, so my world is all about image. And so anything you can do, KP has an adage, never take your apples to market before they're shined, right? or always shine your positive side. Always shine your apples before you take them to market.
Give or take. Yeah. Polish your apples before you go to market.
What the hell? That's even better.
Same thing.
And so that's it, right? So put something fun. Tell me a fun little anecdotal story. Tell me why it touches you. Tell me about all the thought you put into it, right? So even if it's a whimsical story, I just saw a Shark Tank pitched with the most ridiculous dumbass story called the No Phone. It's nothing. It's a box. They pitched them the No Phone, and they didn't get any funding. It was just, you know, it's entertaining for 1 second, but it's not a phone. So that's not functional. So again, tell me the payoff to your product.
As advertised. Any other questions?
Hey, good luck today.
Are you ready to get started? Dun, 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 dun. PR guy, what do you think?
PR guy.
It works.
There you go.
I gave you some shout outs.
Yeah, there
you go. All right. All right, let's just review today's game. So, how long did you get for presentation?
3 minutes, no less than 2 minutes, 45 seconds.
No less than 2 minutes and 30 seconds.
Oh, right, you get a 30 second gap in there, right?
Bad things.
He's got
a
taste.
So, I'll tell you the last time I went over, because I'm so adamant about just being conscious of your time. We took a point off for every second that you were over 3 minutes. So you guys want to do that this time?
No.
No?
Can you give us a hands up if we've got to the point of 2 minutes, 30 seconds?
So you have a stopwatch on your phone?
I do.
I would suggest setting your stopwatch.
Yeah.
So this is all on you guys, right?
You know, welcome to the real world.
Right? I was just starting. So you can tell when Ray and I just start shaking our heads, that's when you know you went too long. So I can help out with it. Right. What else? What else? Any other questions? Right. Be conscious of your time. Right.
And
at the same time, have some fun with this. You know, this is something that you're supposed to have interest in, have passion in. Right. Sell something. You get your 3 minutes in the sun. Right. At 3:01, we'll probably start throwing like a few things at you, paper and whatnot. I wouldn't do that. Right, we will let you know when 3 minutes goes. I do want you to finish your presentation, so I will not interrupt you at the 3 minute mark, but we will let you know how far over you were at the end. All right, any other questions?
For video things, are you going to put that screen down, or how's that going
to
work?
Yeah, you have access to the, that's all going through my computer. You will have access to the PC that's on you, so you can set up your meeting.
Okay.
Any other questions? Two questions.
No.
Who's going first? There he is.
Yeah,
you gotta love that.
All right, so come on over here. We'll get you set up with the PC. We'll get yourself set up. Do you need the PC at all?
Yeah.
Okay. I am roughly certain that I am going to hopefully do a lot of improvement on this, but that's, you know,
you have whatever you want, man. And you let me know when you get started. So you get yourself settled in, I'll get settled in.
Okay, and what is the Okay, what I have here is the base.
It's going to be the Mac or the PC one. Let me give you two more right here. This is PC.
Oh, yes, that was just the PC one. I also did a proper presentation.
Okay, and then you have a keyboard right here.
Okay, then. We'll see if I can access this app. Make sure that this one is the.
It's okay, buddy.
All right, between 2 minutes, 3 seconds, and 3 minutes. I thought it was like between 2 and 45 seconds and some other, well, like maybe a little bit of 3, but I will make it.
Just be here. Be fucking awesome. Just have fun.
Have fun. Actually, I'll honestly gotta say this project was definitely stressful, but once I get this done, I'm just gonna do it, make it happen.
Right? You got fans here, bro.
Got it.
Okay, and then please just you'll introduce yourself to our guests here, and we'll get you started.
Okay, my name is David Patrick. I'm obviously a student here in this creativity course, and I have an idea that I think would sell. Personally, I have always wanted to learn a language, and so learning a language to me has been something that's been, you know, kind of something. It's just I wanted to do it. But every time it felt like I had some maybe reason or excuse to not really do it. And so I have to think about this. What is it that's keeping me from learning a language? The problem is that people in general, there's this language barrier. Everyone's got to communicate. Everyone wants to communicate, myself included. But these language barriers keep people from communicating in other countries, including myself. So I have to ask, what is this problem? And there is a problem. The one problem is motivation. Motivation. People looking on the net and all sorts of stuff, they always said that you have to have the motivation in your own language. It takes time, you have to have the motivation. People don't have motivation, they don't learn the language. And so there's ways to learn language, and all these solutions here, you know, things like teaching from a classroom can end up being boring, you know, and programs like Rosetta Stone, you might think they help, but those things, they're boring too, because it's matching a shape to a word. And language shapes, pretty much the same thing. Rote memorization, you keep hearing things like hola, como estas, over and over again. So they're all boring. Ultimately, it means that your motivation gets crushed, completely crushed. So I was wondering, you know, what is it that people are motivated to do? So I thought, well, fun things. But what do people want to do that's fun? So, you know, some people, they like to play chess, do sports, play board games or other games. But there's one thing that they like to do, and myself included, absolutely. They like to play video games. Look how many video games are here. Tons of them. That's not even half the games that exist. There are probably not as many video games as books, but you can fill an entire room with them for video games and still not be able to walk into it for your average room. So ultimately, I figured, you know, what makes for a good game? A game that has a good story. Well, what makes for good language learning? What makes for good language learning is being able to put your learning of language into practice, such as actually being able to interact in the dialogue. Things like being able to converse with people, you know, maybe if it's about a place like Spain, you could say, hola, como estas, and have people in the game respond back to you. Because if you have it as an interactive experience, like say in a video game, your language learning will do much better. It's interactive, it helps you actively utilize the language, and in learning the language, you will okay, so in interacting with people, it helps you learn language better. Ultimately, it would also include things like, you know, talking to a taxi, going to the market, things like that. Those will also be included in the game. Because, you know, you can have the main story about about something like, say, in this case, an investigator going and studying potential situations for a crime, you know, like looking at all the evidence. But it reports also things like how you want to get from here to there with a taxi, if you need to take a taxi. Ultimately, if you have a good story, it'll do really well. It'll solve the game. But if it's made to also have great gameplay and all those other details, then it will keep people coming back to the game, and they'll basically have it people talk about the successes and make people want to buy the game. Okay. Any questions?
And yes. Yeah, there's no Q&A at the end of this stuff. That's it. Round of applause.
All right.
That's it. The 4-1.
All right, we'll get to judges. Is there any questions, John? You want to give anybody have any questions about this? Okay. So,
Hey, you know, don't worry. You go see.
Well, wait for my. So I should head back to
here. Yeah, you just head back here. You'll get this online. Next up, please.
Oh, okay. I'll go to the house.
Did I get the ceiling camera up?
Yeah,
you just hit Don. And then would it be all right if I
yeah, right? Is that the best part of your presentation? Something like that. Okay. Maybe you're ready, buddy.
So two Thursdays ago, I woke up late for class. My Thursday schedule is 11 to 3. So when I woke up at 10:45, I realized, yeah, I've got to go to class real quick. Brush my teeth, got to be fresh in the morning, of course. And then I grabbed my phone and my laptop. I take notes on my laptop. And by the time I got to class, I realized my phone was dead. My laptop was dead as well. And I had nothing. I couldn't take notes. I couldn't communicate with anyone in the outside world. I couldn't do anything. I felt worthless. And I just sat in class and I thought, as I looked at my laptop and my phone, which were on my desk, what if I had something that could charge these devices? Boom. That was my eureka moment right there. And that's how the WikTok came to be. WikTok. Cool name. I know what you're thinking. But it stands for wireless inductive charger. And the top, tabletop, just abbreviated version. So really, it has a bunch of features, two colors. The first set of colors, black and green. Black and green, cool combination, kind of nitro feel. And the other two are white and blue. Now, I picked these two colors in particular because I thought they're futuristic, they're sleek, everyone would like them. Three different sizes. The biggest size can fit two people side by side right next to each other. And different sizes as well is the biggest one can charge two laptops at the same time, two people can sit right next to each other side by side, as well as two phones. The next size would be a mid-sized table. I have all the sizes right there as well, 36 to 24 inches. And that could do two phones as well as a charger. And the smallest one would be 24 inches by 16, and that's just for a laptop and a phone. So adjustable height. It can go up and down. You can fit a man or a child, whatever size you are, it'll be able to fit, as well as an automatic shut-off feature. Automatic shut-off, and I don't know if you guys know this, but sometimes when you charge your phones, your laptops, if it goes to 100%, it burns out the battery if you just keep it. Now, a lot of companies have adapted to this, but at the same time, you don't want to get your battery burned out. You don't want it to die. And the last question, of course, is who would buy it? Right now, you can kind of see the school's adapted. I see the professor has his laptop plugged in right there. He does as well. But the general population would buy this. It could be really anyone. Seminars, a lot of people bring their laptops and take notes. And there's not enough outlets in the entire room for everyone. So eventually, people are going to have to realize that a table is right there. And you can use something to charge it. An institution can use it. I know everyone in this class has probably taken a test on a laptop before. If you can do all those things, I think it's a perfectly viable market for this product.
Yeah.
That's it. Thank you.
Nice job. All right, who's going to be next? Get yourself set up, please.
I know there's a control panel, there's more than white buttons that you change screen selection.
It's like a button.
Have you learned anything from the two that have gone already?
What did you learn? Dave, what did you learn? Well, I've learned that obviously one of the things to work on is definitely being able to speak off the cuff. That learning to do that will help me better if I just need to talk to something else. Things like the, what is it, 9-second elevator speech or the 30 seconds. But yeah.
Yeah.
So I definitely am not that great at doing it by speaking, so that's something I should focus on.
Right. We'll keep learning along the way. Tony, you want to go right?
Hi, everybody. So here's a close one. The first app when you can easily catalog, swap, bow, lend, buy, and sell by panels around it. So my ideas come from one of my hobbies, which is mixing. So as a DJ and a music lover, I truly believe that panels are the most entertaining way to enjoy music. But the thing is that as a physical object, they are not always convenient to either to sell or to buy. And you know, sometimes I just feel like the need to just borrow a vinyl rather than just, it's kind of expensive actually. And also I realized that there are only a few ways to swap vinyls that you actually don't listen to anymore. So for example, you know, I would just like to meet a new guy and like say, okay, so you get these vinyls, let's make a deal, you know, let's make a trade, like a win-win situation. So I was just thinking about something that could provide all in-one service. So I came up with this idea. So also a well-designed app where you can easily catalog your vinyl collection and interact with lovers near to you in order to trade, borrow, lend, buy, or sell vinyls. So here are some features that could be included into the app. So an interactive map to easily find other users, a barcode scanner to integrate quickly your disc to your collection, different options to put on your vinyl collection, like do I want to swap this vinyl, do I want to lend this one, do I want to sell it, an advanced user profile to see the vinyl collection and the history of previous vinyl transaction, possibility to rate the profile users to deal with, a price guide to help you to sell and lend your disc according to the market value, and fair market value actually, and a smart library correlated with the user switches. So here are some screenshots that's what would look like the app actually. So that would be like a kind of scanner just to scan like the barcode, you know, and that will like easily include it to your album collection when you can like navigate through your all your vinyls, you know, see what you got, the chair, the drop, the albums, whatever. And then here's like the main part. So let's say this is your vinyl, right? So you get three options over here. The first one, the shake hands, is for swap. Otherwise, you get for the land. The dollar is like if you want to sell it, and like this is like if you want to share like the vinyl you just acquired recently. And otherwise, you get all the description over there. And this would be like the option just like to find out all the other users just around you. So this quote is really important. I found it on the internet on the forum, you know. And so the guy say, I used to lend people my records freely, but after a good friend returned a classic record quite 200 grand precious to me covered in fingerprints and scraps, now I'm not so willing to lend my records even if they are valuable or not. I don't think it's appropriate to teach friends how to handle a record, so I let it go. However, it created a difficult situation. This sentence is massively important because when you lend something, of course you don't want to get it back damaged. So that's why the profile user is paramount to ensure the other users are trustful and respectful you are regarding the vinyls. Also, if user wish to lend one of his vinyl, the deposit of the actual value of the vinyl would be asked additionally to the price to rent the disc. Few words about the market potential. So according to MusicWatch, half the vinyl record buyers in the US are under the age of 25. So that's why smartphone app appears as the most efficient and relevant way to reach my customer targets. And you can actually have the vinyl album sales have skyrocketed since 2014, whereas the physical and digital album sales are slightly dropped. Finally, the implementation. So the only thing I need for this kind of app is just a good web developer, a web designer. Then I would do, of course, a test phase just to have like the first feedback and a recommendation before the launch phase. But the app will be available on the App Store and the Google Play for free. And regarding the revenue streams, the company would earn 5% on each vinyl board sold or board length. So which means, like for example, if I want to buy a vinyl for $20, 5% would be $1 of the vinyls, like $21 for the vinyl, and the company earn $1. Any question? Thank you.
Watch out for that kid.
I got it.
Hello everybody and welcome to my presentation on kinetic wheels. Now, before I came up with this idea, I first started thinking about common problems and issues that we all face today. And that's when I realized that environmental concerns are a big issue nowadays. And most of this is caused by the high pollution generated from vehicles. And I especially remember this growing up in Bogota, Colombia, where there's a lot of pollution, a lot of cars, traffic is heavy. So I thought, how could businesses help with such a common issue if they have the investment and resources to do so? So my idea had to be creative, and the main philosophy that I would use when coming up with this idea would be, how can we utilize the high level of energy generated from vehicles? Because we're going to carry on using vehicles. Vehicles are still going to carry on polluting. So why not be creative and utilize what the vehicles do? And that's when I thought of pipe turbine generators. So basically, electricity is generated from generators, and turbines, which are connected to the generator, generate electricity. So I thought, what if we had these turbines installed across from the roads, and then cars would go over these turbines, rotation motion, and many of these pipes, turbines, installed to one big generator, which would generate electricity for streets and local businesses. So the advantages of this method was that cars are, you know, generating electricity for the streets. I did think of potential concerns, which are safety. So you're probably thinking, you know, what if the bumps are too much of an inconvenience to the cars? But the whole pipe doesn't need to be on the road. It's only about less than a quarter of the road. It's just a little bit of contact. That's why it's kinetic wheels. And that's going to cause rotary movement. They would also be installed many meters apart from each other, so it's not a consistent bump. It's just one bump every 5-6 meters. And also the big generator would be installed, you know, in a far distance away from the road, so it's not causing any hazards or anything. So who benefits? So what does this mean for the driver? Well, actually it means nothing. They just got to carry on commuting as they always do. And at the same time, they're going to be powering local streets. And the businesses would actually be quite smart for them, because the businesses like bars, restaurants, and malls, they're the ones that use up a lot of electricity during the day. So if they were to invest in these generators just across the road from them, cars would actually be generating electricity for their business, which would mean long-term cost benefits. So that would be involved with any potential investments. And thanks for listening.
Okay, so hello everybody. So this is my project. I'm going to show it first to you. So I've got a small contest. Oh, where's the... So here's the presentation is structured. So I'm going to go through all those points. So first thing first, how the idea came to me. So basically, I was looking for an idea for this presentation. I couldn't find anything. So I just decided to take a break and go to Starbucks, have a coffee. So obviously, it was the Starbucks on campus, and it took me like 15 minutes to get my coffee, 10 minutes waiting in line, and the extra 5 minutes once you order your product, you gotta wait until you can get it actually. And so I thought about a couple of things during this time. So the first thing is, in the line, you can see that more and more people are like buying Starbucks items. They're all over the place right now. Also, the fact that people are waiting once you order, the 5 minutes you get to wait, people are waiting, like doing nothing, basically looking at the phone, looking at each other, like it's really useless 5 minutes. It's useless both for Starbucks and its customers. I also thought about the fact that maybe Starbucks customers would like to be more involved in the brand, which is not the case for now. And also thought about the fact that during this class, you can learn that everybody and everyone can be innovative and creative. So I was trying to find a way to use those elements in a way to like improve the business and take advantage of it. So I thought about a couple of questions. So how do you use those 5 minutes to benefit the brand as well as the customers? How do you get feedback from them during those 5 minutes? Also, how to motivate customers and use the fact that everybody is creative and innovative in order to improve the business. So I thought about a couple of ideas, a couple of things, and I try to mix them up and find the best solution, and this is what I came up with. So basically, it will be a kind of a contest and a sweepstakes in the same moment. So the first thing is, so you're ordering your coffee or whatever, and for an extra dollar, you can get like a customized Starbucks pen and a card like this. So on the card, you're gonna have to fill this information, so it's the information so Starbucks can come back to you, and they also get data about you. And the other one is the most important side. Like on the other side of the card, you got those questions, and the most important is the last one. So what would be the end order Starbucks experience? So this way, waiting for his order, the customer is able to like fill it and put it in one of the boxes that are in the store. And basically, every month, Starbucks is going to give them two prices. So the first one is for one customer choosing at random. That will have the less valuable price, obviously. And the first prize comes to the customers that came up with the best creative and innovative idea in order to improve either the products or the Starbucks experience. So this will benefit actually both Starbucks and the customers. Starbucks, because they get data about the customers, so they can elaborate new strategies, be more accurate about it. The word of mouth is going to stimulate activity. The customers are going to be involved. That will create brand loyalty. They'll get feedbacks from the customers, so they can change and adapt to the customer's expectation, which is not the case for now. They can use customers' creativity and get new ideas from them instead of hiring people and paying them like a lot of money. And for the customers, well, they get different prices. So I just took a couple of examples. I don't know if it's just random. And they're involved in the brand development, which is not the case for now. And they're able to give the personal feedback. So basically, from this previously 5 minutes, like useless both for the customers and Starbucks, just trying to make the best of it for both sides. So basically, this is my idea. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Any questions? How many people would sign up while you're waiting in line? How many people would draw funny cartoon characters on the thing for you?
Okay, so hello everybody. Before beginning this presentation, I would like to with me two volunteers, just 15 seconds to like make more like involvement of everybody. And so can I have like two athletic people to help me? Okay, what I'm going to ask you guys is to show me what you would do at the training, like in 15 seconds, like one for cardio training, what would you do with that in equipment, and the other one for like to train the strength in your shoulder or...
You go cardio.
Okay. So 15 seconds. Are you ready, guys? Three, two, one, go! One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 11. Thank you, guys. Thank you for your time. We did good. So, basically, I came from a daily conversation with my two roommates. They're quite different. One is a bodybuilder, the other is an exchange student. And what's common about those two people is that they like move in and out and travel all around the world. And their common issue was that they would like to work out at home or outside and be able to carry all their, this equipment. So I basically listened to my first roommate, who's a bodybuilder and a personal trainer, and she told me like her basic problem is that she has to go to her work and then come back and train her clients and stuff, and sometimes she can't carry all her material, and she needs, like, she always forgets something, and that's really inconvenient because then she has to rethink the workout, and that's kind of complicated. And for the other roommate, which Wu is an exchange student, she needs to revise stuff and resell her equipment, and that's really convenient too. So I came up with the idea of the 2.0 rope, which is in fact like a huge cage where you could have like just the size of a rope, so a normal rope that you can work on your cardio. The rope would be actually like an elastic band, which could help you to work on your strength, on your elasticity, flexibility, and the last one would be actually handle. The handle would be weights of different weights, and you can like just jump with more intensity and work on your strength. And this would be like removable, so you can use it separately if you need it. And so when I presented first this project, someone told me like, will you have like a man kit or a woman kit? Actually, like, people and women can have more strength than men, it's true, and men can have more flexibility than women. So the kit would be the same. What's going to be different is that you will have a special badge to carry it, because you need to carry it everywhere, so you need to have something. For example, the busy men, you will need to have something fancy, will look classy, and could fit your suits. The athletes and the pretty woman, if you need to be cool in every kind of situation. So here is my ID. Thank you.
Thank you.
Again, please make sure that you introduce yourself. Ray is taking notes and doesn't know everybody. And before we get started, so any big observations so far? Generic, specific, what are you seeing? No, everybody's just in awe of everybody. You're all awesome.
He's lost the words.
It's pretty cool to see all the presidents and everybody's kind of collaboration with themselves. And it's cool to see everybody's presentation, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I like seeing the visuals and like the pictures. It really helps us see the idea come to life.
Mm-hmm. I have to tell you, I was expecting to see more like tangible prototype types of things so far, right? Like, could be like, what's the badge, the jump rope stuff? Where is the Starbucks, like, why not like give everybody Starbucks stuff at the beginning of your presentation? Because at the end of the presentation, it'd be almost the same time as they've waiting in for the Google stuff on them, right? More of that kind of stuff. That audience participation stuff was good, right? They, you know, the thing getting people involved makes it more interesting. Moving around, working with the content when you went up to the screens, that kind of stuff, I think, works well. Any other great observations so far? All right, we'll keep them moving. Yes?
So hello everybody, my name is Ines Poggi. I'm an international student here coming from France, and I'm here to present you my new ID. So where my ID comes from is because when I was in high school, I was always hearing some complaints about my friends saying like, oh my god, I can't write too much because I'm tired of writing all the time, etc. I have lots of essays. It's just a lose of time, etc. So I was just thinking about something really simple, but which could be efficient and easy for everybody to carry while you are writing, obviously. So my idea is a mix between the Zuta portable printer. It's like a really small printer, the size of a lemon, basically, and a self-standing pen. So it's a pen which can just stand by itself on a paper. So if you want to zoom in a bit, you can see the two products. Those kind of products, they doesn't exist now on the market. They are not, you can't find it in stores or whatever. It's just some products I found on the internet from real companies who are trying to launch those kind of products. So I wanted to find products which are already kind of existing because I can just like try to put new features on it, and it's easier for putting like high technology into my ideas because I'm not studying engineering, so it's kind of hard. So my idea is a free pen. So yeah, you can see there is a USB charger because you have like 8 hours battery. You have an ink cartridge which you can write 350 pages with it. You have some lateral camera because the pen needs like a to visualize the space on the paper in order to just move by itself. And you have the writing part, which is going to be like just close to the paper. So what are the features of my pen? So you can choose the language when you're buying it. I try to find the cost not that high because it's going to be for mostly students. But I think 49 was the price which could work because I studied a lot, like all the portable printer I always found on the market, and you can find one like around $24. So 49 seems a reasonable price for it. And so finally, what would work and what we did attract customers, because it's again a time. You can listen to the class while you can write some notes just next to, like, just while listening to the teacher and to the lectures. You can also like write when you're talking on the phone, for example, because it's really annoying to carry your phone and take some notes, for example, so you can just like speak loudly. And when you are writing, for example, your flashcards, because I know it's something like American are doing a lot here, so you can just like say to your friend what you want to write, like all your lessons, etc. So it's easier for you to learn. And so that's why now writing can become a freedom.
Thank you.
It's French version.
We're gonna break the streak. You couldn't tell I'm not one of our French foreign exchange students.
Okay. Never heard of it.
All right. Hello, everybody. My name is Stephen Fox. I'm going to be talking about a way that we can automate a lot of our personal financial management. So, in my experience as a financial planner for the last few years, I've realized something that kind of sucks as a financial planner, which is that most people really don't need the services that financial planners provide. And a lot of what we do revolves around things like managing your portfolio to try and find excess return, or estate planning, or really complicated tax strategies. But for most people, you don't need any of that. For a lot of us, really the only thing you need to do to improve your financial situation, it's as simple as finding a way to either make more money or spend less money. Just make sure that you're making more than you spend and saving something. If you do that, pretty much everything else in your finances is going to be okay, right? For most of us, if you don't own a business, you have pretty limited control over how you can make more money. There are only a few things you can do. What we have a lot of control over is how much money that we spend. That's a pretty simple idea, but simple isn't necessarily the same as easy. There are a couple of big barriers to that. And one of them is laziness. As you can see from my buddy Homer here, a lot of people are really lazy and don't want to take the time to figure out ways to save money, or even if they do want to take the time to find ways and figure out how they can pinch pennies and save money on all these different things that they buy, it's a little bit difficult to do because we only have so much time to be able to do it. You can only trade so much time for money. So we don't do it, really. So part of the solution for this is you can combine account aggregation services, like Mint.com is really popular. Some of you might use it. There are several million people who do, where it just sorts all of your accounts in one consolidated place and you can see what you're spending in different categories. Combine that with other services that find ways to automatically save you money without the user really having to do anything at all. So the way this would work is we would have kind of a personal finance dashboard where you see everything in one consolidated view, and on top of that you would add modules that perform different functions. So one of these modules would be a bill detector module that would scan through your email account, your credit card, bank statements to find the bills that you pay, and then it would compare with averages for people in your demographic. So let's say you're a 20-year-old single male in a one-bedroom apartment in this zip code. It would know that your average electric bill should be about $53 a month. Well, by looking at your bills, it knows that your average has been $150 a month. So it sends you an alert and say, hey, buddy, you're spending three times what you should on your electricity bill. Here's a link to Amazon to buy some high-efficiency light bulbs. Here's the phone number of a local electrician that can fix your thermostat so your AC doesn't run all the time. It finds ways to make it easy for you to save money. Next one would be subscription finder module. Subscription pricing has become a pretty popular model among businesses in the last few years, and pretty much all of us have some subscriptions that we've forgotten about and don't even use anymore. This would scan through your email and just give you a summary and allow you to click on whichever ones you want to cancel, automatically submit the cancellation request to that company for you. Next one is an auto refund module that would scan your receipts in your email account from any online shopping that you do. It would monitor the prices. A lot of big companies, Amazon and others, change the prices thousands of times each day, and you would never know it after you buy the product. So it'll look up the items that you bought, and whenever there's a price change and you're within the refund window, it'll automatically submit a request on your behalf for a refund for the difference. Customer has to do nothing. So the business model for this, it'd be free to sign up and use some of the basic modules. And I've come up with about a dozen modules. There's all different kinds, but some of them would take a percentage of the amount saved and charge automatically. It's a highly scalable model because you don't really need to bring in more employees. There's no inventory to hold, nothing like that. It's just software, so it's fairly easy. We'd start with the basics and add modules and kind of iterate as we go to improve the service. Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah.
in regards to the model taking percentage of what was saved, when it comes to things that have a continuous savings, would it take percentage of that on a one-time basis or annual basis?
No, that's not going to save anybody money. If you cancel this thing that you're paying $20 a month for, well, we're going to charge you $5 a month for the rest of your life instead.
That's not doing anybody any favors. So it would be limited, yeah.
Well, yeah, I figured it would be forever, like, you know.
But it would be, I think it's fair, it makes sense to make a proportion of the amount of money that you're saving people. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
I feel like I'm way down.
You're like 9 minutes, man.
Yeah. That's what you're doing. Oh, I was just getting a good part.
Sanford.
Old guys know that song.
All right, so. Oh, by the way, my name is Chris. Wouldn't you guys like, you know, to create a product for an innovative, or create an innovative product for an industry that has a, nearly a $70 billion economic impact per year? I know I would. So one day, while playing golf with one of my buddies, just got tired of losing so many balls, mostly because I'm a, you know, pretty crappy player, but came up with this idea to create this golf ball that you can track on your phone and thus never lose another golf ball unless, of course, you send it to the water. So then you'd be kind of screwed there. So here's a little video of, you know, the whole process and stuff I came up for this golf ball.
Alright guys, so displayed here are the different stages in order to manufacture this GPS chip that goes inside the golf ball. The first step would be the company would have to be able to set the GPS chip in the core of the golf ball. As shown here, we have a chip inserted into the actual core of the golf ball. The next step would be finishing up the manufacturing process of creating the whole inner part of the golf ball. And the last piece would be right here, where we take this piece and get it set in the outer golf ball shell. And here's what the finished product would look like, just like any other golf ball. That would be perfectly balanced and work, made to work just like any other golf ball.
Thanks.
There we go. Yes, yes, the crowd goes wild. Just whenever you're ready, buddy.
How's it going, everybody? My name is Bruce Gilmore. My name is Bruce Gilmore, and I'm going to be talking about my design thinking presentation. So I'm going to start with a quick video to demonstrate the problem I'm going to be talking about. I hope this sound works. And you could say, obviously, wear a watch, but here are some of the reasons why people don't wear a watch. They either forget, or you don't have a waterproof watch, or you have an expensive watch that you don't want to get damaged, you know, leather band, whatever. So there's a bunch of reasons why people don't wear watches, and there's an issue of not knowing what time it is. I personally, I've had a few experiences where I was late to class or work because I was being selfish and I wanted to catch more waves. And I know a lot of people have had that experience too. Even this past weekend, I had a dude literally paddle like 200 feet just to come see if I had a watch, to figure out what time it was, and he ended up being late to work because it was like 2:30. Anyway, so there's an issue. And the people that this targets are surfers and water enthusiasts. Pretty much anybody in the ocean or anyone that can't have access to a watch. I've surfed for over 6 years, and almost every session that I'm wearing a watch, people will come and ask me what time it is because a lot of people don't wear a watch. Like I said, I explained the story already. Another thing, so a solution. I had to figure out a way to integrate a watch into something a surfer had with them already. So whether that was the wetsuit or a surfboard, two obvious things that you need. Living here in California, the water gets pretty cold, could be in the mid-50s during winter, so a wetsuit is like a no-brainer. On the other hand, a surfboard is another thing that you have to surf, obviously. But the only issue is that if you had some kind of watch module on there, you may forget to switch between boards. A lot of people have multiple boards, so that could be a problem forgetting. So ended up thinking about the wetsuit. The website's been around for a while. It's essentially served one purpose of keeping users warm. It's improved throughout the past couple of years with technology. I looked at it as maybe there's another purpose that we can use Wetsuit for. So I ended up prototyping a watch into the sleeve of Wetsuit. I took an old Wetsuit that I had and I cut a watch in there. The watch isn't working, it's just for demonstration purposes. But this would essentially solve the problem of not having a watch in the water. You know, you're always going to wear your Wetsuit and you're always going to know what time it is. And especially now with watches having tide monitors and future tide readings, you can know if the session is going to get better or worse and plan accordingly. And finally, to finish out market potential, the surf industry is going to have a $13 billion market by 2017. So that's a lot of money. And surfers typically buy wetsuits every 1 to 3 years, depending on how much you use it. You know, if you use it every day, it'll probably last a year and a half, and depending on how you take care of it. So if you can integrate this watch into a wetsuit, you wouldn't have a problem. And you'd obviously be selling them every few years. And as I mentioned before, the combination of a surf watch into a wetsuit would be the best of both worlds. And any questions? And here's some sources I have.
You did not bring your prototype to.
I was going to, but my wetsuit's kind of nasty, so.
Oh, okay. There you go. I understand.
But there was a picture.
Yeah.
Hey, my name is Naveed. You can also call me Nav. Either way, works. So I created this smart airwave energy sourcing, or SAWS. So basically, the story behind this: I was at Starbucks one day. I was like on so much Adderall and coffee. I don't know what you're drinking, but white mocha, iced white mochas, those are good. I was drinking one of those, and I was so frustrated at just like why my phone wasn't charging. And I was so frustrated, probably because of the Adderall too, but it's just like, I was just, you know, so confused why I wasn't charging, and I realized it wasn't even plugged into my laptop, the USB end. So I just started thinking of just like what consumers wanted, like their energy needs in general, and also just like how and when they get their energy. Let's see here. So basically, the idea is I would source energy from the wave activity that's already present in the air. This includes microwaves, AM, FM, radio waves, signals coming to and from your cell phone. And then I would accumulate all the very small, just like little energy packets that are attached to those airwaves. And then I would amplify those and then output the energy through the USB. And this little thing I drew, basically you can see like there's like the wave that has data and energy tied onto it, and then it would accumulate all those right here. Well, then the antennas would pick it up, and then they would basically turn the energy into like a usable voltage, even though it's like extremely small. It would accumulate all those together, and then It would use an amplifier to amplify it to usable voltage, so you power things like a USB. So pretty much how I got there was the, you know, the story with Starbucks just realizing like you know, the charger wasn't plugged in, and I thought, oh, well, this is part of the empathize phase. So I asked questions like consumers need, and kind of putting myself in their shoes, kind of see like what would be really cool, like a really cool way I could bring this to market. So a bunch of ideas. I connected two ideas that I actually had to make this. So it was kind of sourcing energy from like garbage or just any recycled materials like that, and also like an energy sucking type of vacuum. And yeah, so then I eventually got to the final smart airwave energy sourcing idea. So I have a prototype here. It would be about, you know, not too big. It has like USBs on the front. Then it would have a little switch right there. And because the antennas are constantly receiving that energy, there's no like charging time, like initial charging time. So you don't have to like turn it on, wait for it to like gather all the air and stuff and use it. You can literally just turn it on, use it. And because it's only receiving it, there's no interference. I know that was a big question I got. So there's that. And let's see here. So yeah, so essentially you just take this, you know, plug it in there, charge it, you're good to go. And yeah, so the market potential for this, there's over 10 billion USB products right now. There's over 3 billion that are being shipped out every single year. And what all these have in common is that all these USB products, like, you know, your phones, tablets, whatever, they need to get power from somewhere. So, you know, usually people are just plugging them in or using the induction charging, which is actually probably like the biggest competitor to this technology. And, you know, some good things about that, there's a marketplace. So we know you know, they're in Starbucks, they're in libraries, some people have it personally. And it's also convenient. So, you know, you can just take your phone, throw it somewhere, it's charging. You don't have to take it, plug it in. You know, that's so much more of a hassle. But then it's also slow. That's the thing. So essentially what I'm doing is I'm taking the energy that would, so instead of like wireless charging, how you, wireless part is you putting your phone on the actual charging unit and that's how it does it. It's the wireless part is moved to actually sourcing the energy wirelessly and then plugging your phone in. So it's going to be like really fast, and you know, all that is going to be just included in that little device there. And yeah, that's it. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
So with this device, it is a particularly strong source of airwave energy. Is there a possibility for the collector device itself to use overload or anything like that?
I don't think so. I mean, it's really low power. It's just a USB, so yeah, there shouldn't be any like power problems with it at all.
No power problems with it. But what about the device collector itself? Not just the batteries that or phone or whatever might be connected to the device.
Yeah. So like when it accumulates all the, is that what we're talking about, like the voltage accumulating? So basically it's like, well, that little electronic is just like just a little unit to like the whole thing, and very well available. So just there's shouldn't be too many power problems with it. Let's see.
Let's get pumped up, baby. Let's go. Take two trips, got too many props. Always come prepared.
I already love this.
Brutal.
Hello, viewers. Mom, Dad, thank you for watching. All right. Oh, my name is Taylor Cook, by the way, so I can receive my credit. Thank you. So, roughly a month ago, a tragedy befell me. I miss half of March Madness. So, I realized, I said, am I the only one? This can't be. Exactly, another fallen soldier. Anyway, so, I cannot be the only one. So, I did some soul searching. I went down, walking aimlessly. I did not know where I was going. But then, an idea struck, and I stuck with it. I want to stick it to cable companies, man, because I didn't have a cable subscription, so I couldn't watch March Madness. So, I decided I have a product for you, and you, and you, and all of you. So, I want to create a streaming service. Now, I know what you're thinking. Wait, those already exist, right? Well, yes, they do. There's like Netflix, Hulu, Sling TV, or Sling TV. See, can't even get your name right. Anyway. But here's where mine varies. Mine will be all for sport content. So think of the iTunes of sports. Customers can subscribe to just a game. Think of it as a single iTunes. And, or they can buy the whole album, subscribe to a whole team's games for the whole season, or events like March Madness, so no one ends up like me. Now, was I alone? I don't know. So I started doing some potential market research. And I realized, by interviewing San Diego State University students, that there is actually a need for this. Because I asked all of you, and you said there was. So then I started doing some design thinking. You know, I asked about every, recorded what people wanted, and I realized there is a problem here. Cable subscriptions are too dang high, okay? So my service would be a way around that. And yeah, and oh, just in case, if you think, well, how are you going to get all that content there? What are you going to have? Well, I'll tell you what we're going to have. We would have football, man. We would have Aztecs and basketball, man. Again, Aztecs basketball, man. We got all of it. You know what? You want to do whatever? Anyway, you can have running right here. Check this out. Family friendly. Family friendly. We're good here. You can have running. Do whatever you want. All right, anyway, so any questions, guys? That's my product.
So, I don't know what to go with that. That's awesome. There you go. Oh yeah, right? I do.
I'll take two chairs.
Yeah. That.
I'm going to go.
All right, so while he's getting ready there,
who enjoyed the last presentation?
Why?
Wow, one person.
Why?
Because it was entertaining.
It was entertaining.
What else was it?
Use your words.
What was it?
Why did you enjoy it?
I think it was animated, like really active, animated, engaging.
Hmm? Anybody else?
It was creative.
Yeah. Anybody else?
Visual.
Right, so that's the kind of stuff, right? That's kind of, those are the kind of presentations that get people jazzed up, right? That because people do want to have fun, but it brings the content, the material to life, right? And especially when you're in a room full of presentations, doesn't it distinguish itself from the others, right? So very nice job. Thank you.
One way to distinguish itself is that a lot of these other presentations use some form of PowerPoint or presentation and stuff like that. This one used them back.
No.
Okay, ready?
No pressure now or
anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So my name's Reese. I'm basically back not a hobby, but in my free time I like to bet, gamble, go out with friends, chill out. It's a big thing in Europe. And coming over I found that it's not as big as a market as potentially it could be. I mean, everyone goes down to bars, enjoys watching games, but there's not really the marketplace for it on apps or Androids. So this is an overview of the type of product that I'd like to design and have customers going for.
The Betfair sports betting app is a great way to place and manage your bets on the move. Once logged in, we're able to access every market available on the sportsbook and place bets in the usual way. Along the bottom are tabs for other useful areas of the sports betting app. On the home screen, you can see links to popular sports and features, such as football and the next five horse races. All the sports available to bet on are listed under the sports tab. Additionally, all active in-play events are easily accessible by clicking the in-play tab. Promotions displays all the fantastic bonuses and cashback specials.
So that's the general overview of the type of product that I would like to design. So it's called BetFriends, the new interactive way of betting. The current marketplace in last year, or in 2012, it accounted for £55 billion in regulated revenue, and this is rise to £70 billion in 2016, so a 5.4% increase, which is growing all the time, especially in the Asian markets, where it's highly regulated, and this is the one of the major markets. So currently in the UK at home, 4.4 iPhone users have some type of betting application on their mobile, which they can have at any point. As I say, in America, currently the only state that is allowed a full sports betting menu is Nevada, and the only one where you can do single game wagering, which is the most popular form of betting within the US. However, this may be set to change, and I would like to be a part of that change. As we see, Americans are the highest losers through gambling at £119 billion a year. So ultimately, this application can change that. The marketplace potential. So within the NFL college game, college and the NFL itself, it's expected to reach £95 billion just on two sports alone. America seems to be the sleeping giant in this market, and $12.4 billion in annual revenue could be generated. So as you say, five times bigger than the UK, 11 times greater than Italy. In 2015, six states within the US applied to have sports betting bills considered. And with the NBA being as big as it is, one of the major sports leading the way. So what is BetFriend? It would be a mobile / website application in which you create a profile such as you do with your, for example, I don't know, Tinder or whatever you use. So you link in through Facebook, create a profile about yourself, your team, who you support, what you like to do. So it's a new way of contacting with friends and family. You set up private leagues or join world leagues and watch in live time. Current problem, people don't feel value for money, no social interaction with others. It's just you and the betting company. Again, legal in the majority of states. And you could have governments generate taxes from the law being passed. So how is it innovative? You get accurate probabilities based on statistics that have happened in the past. So therefore, I mean, you should, in theory, lose less money as you have the past statistics of what's happened. One-on-one, and also the points accumulated from what other people are betting on. So you may get a greater return on your investment and daily prizes. So thank you for listening to
Four minutes, 18 seconds. Great. Running long. You guys have to be cognizant of how far you are into your presentation. Sometimes there will be consequences for your long run. Sometimes you get somebody just to, you know, ring a bell, shut off the mic, grab out a hook, and whatever. Right? So just being on time with that just demonstrates organizational structure. Look, how many more people we have to go yet? Raise your hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's it, 8. Okay, we keep moving click. Let's get through this. So,
Hi everyone, my name is Sarah, and my business idea is to start open like a store for the clothes for the overweight children. that offer the clothes for a different body shape. I came up with my idea because I always see my parents have a hard time to find like clothes that fit my brother well. So for the marketing strategy, we will use different aspects to attract as many customers as we can. So we will have like the fashion line have many different styles, like for the casual and the sport and evening look. And we will also have accessories like a handbag, hat, and shoes, maybe belt. And the targeting market will be like the children from newborn to 12 years old. And why this store will be like different from the other store, like the, we offer like a free fashion consultant and tips and affordable and high quality clothes. So here's like a quote, I'm not overweight, I'm just 9 inches too short. That's it.
One minute, 16 seconds.
You did say speed.
Oh, I think so.
Come back here with a job. The place is yours. But don't worry, I yelled.
Hey guys, my name is Ron, currently a San Diego State student. How many of you guys like to drink beer?
Woo!
Right? So I want to ask you guys another question. How many of you guys actually like to go to PB and drink beers over there? So a little bit of background story of who I am. I actually was from the Alvarado Apartments where I was a trans student there. And from there, I actually realized that a lot of people I met over there were all from international areas. And I realized it was like studying abroad was brought to me. So a little bit about this. Have any of you guys heard of Kaizen Sushi before? Okay, so what it is basically a revolving conveyor belt where they serve sushi. And it's something that goes like this.
Inside, plates of sushi trundle past diners on a conveyor belt. This is Conveyor Belt Sushi, a dining concept that lets customers pick from a wide range of Japan's best known foods.
So instead of serving sushi, what if we actually served American beer? And not only American beer, but any kind of beer from around the world. What this will do is it'll help serve a lot of people by showing them what it's like to be studied abroad when you go out and try new types of beer out there. There's also a huge market industry that's a huge potential. It's about $6.5 billion in industry. About $3.4 million around there as well. So just because of this assassination, it allowed me to think, you know, all the people that I've met throughout the career or throughout my San Diego State career that I've introduced to this, it showed them that this is actually a huge fascination and they really like this experience more than just getting a beer from a bartender and, you know, going through this communications that could potentially happen through that. And that will solve that problem. A lot of, about this restaurant would be too, is that it just became more of an ambiance of more casual instead of very hyperactive. It's also, what it'll also have is a QR code at the very bottom, which will be on every coaster saying a little bit more information about that country, a little bit more information about that beer and its origins, so people can understand more about that beer from that country. So at the end of the day, you know, my mission is not really here to just solve miscommunication from this experience of serving beer, but it's also to drink and it's really to bring the studying abroad experience to you guys. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. 206. So now it takes less effort to drink more beer because I don't have to get up and go get it. It will come to me.
It'll come to you.
Close to your presentation, so just be careful about getting stuff too far away.
Yeah.
Okay.
She will start to think.
Very good.
So my name's Connor Lakey. I'm going to talk about the products that I've been working on for this project. So firstly, I'm going to talk about the design thinking stage of the process. First thing I did was to empathize with you know, the standard American household to see, you know, what small problems that could be solved with this project, with the constraints of all the project, you know, the time, the work that we could put in. The result I had was a small problem, or actually a pretty big problem, reducing the energy consumption of the average US household. By defining this in a, by putting in the user perspectives and making a statement, it was easy for me to find one small problem that this like fairly small project could solve. So in California right now, obviously we all know we're in a big drought. It's a 4-year drought, actually record breaking. 20,000 jobs have been lost so far in California. And the economy suffered $2.7 billion burn. So the props I've used perspectives for this project should be something that's easy to use, user-friendly, a low retail price, minimum minimal maintenance, and effective at its job, which would be reducing energy consumption and saving people money. So this is how it started. I started with a shower timer. It's pretty simple. Stick it to your shower wall. Capture how you've been in the shower, you try and reduce that each time. From there, it went into, I built into the shower head, then I realized that's probably going to be too expensive. Then it turned into portable adhesive, maybe a timer app. Then it turned into a water consumption app. And finally, was a water consumption app for all appliances in the house. So the prototyping for this is essentially going to be an iPhone app to start off with. And even though the presentation's done, these are the prototypes for the various stages of the iPhone app. So you can have, you can completely personalize it to yourself. It gives you daily energy saving tips. You can compare your energy stats to other households across the country. So the innovative features of this app are the entire app will be personalized to suit you. Basically, what the idea would be is you select all your appliances from a large list built into the app, and then you that becomes completely personalized, the most accurate reading possible. It gives you a weekly update of the energy saved and the energy you can save in both percentage form and also in terms of like fiscal savings you could also save. The data is represented in graph and chart format for ease of readability, because we're basically aiming to make an app for the most, essentially the laziest person possible. That's the only way they want to use the app and try and save money. Marketability, large open market, minimal high quality competition. The current trend towards sustainability is always growing, especially in California. It offers users a chance to lower their energy bills each month. So, you know, they're, even though they have to spend a small amount of money for this, they actually gain back a lot of money each month. The pricing options are free, content, and $2 a month, which also includes desktop software, which you can connect. So one day I was sitting in this class and I was thinking about how peaceful it was to take a crap in the woods. Tracking and stuff. So that got me thinking about, you know, you having to burn your toilet paper and stuff. And it got me thinking of the importance of fire. And whenever I go backpacking, I always need like a good source of fire. So this is my go-to life, just a basic Zippo. But the Zippo's failed me. Seeing the Zippo, like fuel evaporates pretty quickly. You have other like Bic, but Bic isn't too good because it's not windproof. And then other lighters, they just face the same problem as the Zippo. Fuel is always a problem. So it got me thinking, like, I need a backup. And I know a lot of people who like go backpacking or camping, they'll use a fire steel. And if you guys don't know what a fire steel is, this is a fire steel. Now that, take a little blade, make sparks. So I was thinking about investing into a fire steel, but then I got thinking, is there a product that already has these two? And there really wasn't. So I started thinking, there's three things that people, consumers in this market are looking for. Something that's lightweight, compact. Lighters already, I don't think they're reliable because you need the fire steel to feel like get that ease of mind. So I came up just combining the two. Pretty simple idea. I'm surprised nobody decided to do this. This is my first design I made, 3D model. Just have a basic fire steel come out if the lighter goes bad or whatever. And you can strike this so you always have a source of fire. Now, sales in this market are continuing to grow. with the introduction of new trends. So more people are going out and camping and doing things like that. Survivalists, you know, Naked and Afraid, everybody is in right now. By 2019, this whole market is expected to be worth about $5 billion. So this is a growing. I think this is good because this is the first product to use this technology. Nobody's really done it yet. And it's just, this market is into gimmicks, new things, and they want to try these things out. It's a growing market, as I said, and meets the three requirements that they're looking for. Something that's lightweight, reliable, compact. So, thank you. This is where I'm at now, so like this.
All right. Actually, the next one set up. Excuse me. Please raise your hand if you haven't presented yet. Give me a count. 1, 2, 3, 4. All right. Hey, man, we can go grab a bite in between. Bite that dinner.
I'm Josh Thomas, and I'm going to be talking about my creativity and innovation proposal today on augmented reality and amusement park rides. So my initial inspiration was when I was sitting at one of these little simulated racer games in the Dave and Buster's, and I was thinking back to the fact that, you know, I've actually ridden in a go-kart, and why aren't these two things combined together in the same entertainment object? And the reason that this would be potentially opening up new markets is because they actually target the similar demographics. So you're looking at usually kids ages, say, 5 to about 24. They end up being majority male. And they also both come from multi-billion dollar industries. The video industry is looking at almost $90 billion from last year. And if you consider go-karts to be part of amusement park rides, you're looking at a multi-billion dollar multinational industry as well in that direction. So where I went with my ideation here was first impression, virtual reality, obvious, not going to work there because the problem is that you can't see what's actually in front of you. So you want to really bring in that experience of the actual go-kart and the speed and the adrenaline of that physical object. The Google Glass seems like a pretty good direction to go after that, but unfortunately it has a pretty limited view and display trajectory. With the transparent display panel, it becomes sort of a futuristic dream at this point, because the technology hasn't necessarily caught up to the point where we're looking at a full windshield with a transparent display. So I backtracked a little bit into an augmented reality concept. And for those of you who may not be familiar with this technology, I have a quick display here. And then they also interact, going to the
So there, we saw little bear get taken off by the ninja, but. That is okay because he's not actually real. So you wonder what it might look like. We have a go-kart here from the first person perspective. Basically just going to have a display screen right on there, and it's going to attach in that manner. So you have the camera, the display, the radio frequency identification chips that would allow identification of the location of the objects in virtual reality as well as the cart on the track. You end up with a display looking something like this, a combination of that video feed along with virtual interactive objects where you can get a booster to speed you up. You got the map on the side and the indicator of what placement you might be in. And this can be expanded to other attractions as well. It seems to have pretty unlimited potential with account login, statistical profiles, and you could almost even make a full theme park integration out of it. Thanks for your time. Any questions?
Questions? Who wants to go play? Here's God. It would be great if you could have brought one in and we could have played it.
Yes.
Nice job. Just on a side note, we have some former students watching, posting comments on LinkedIn. So if anybody wants to check that out.
Where can you see that?
Go to talk on my, I posted up off of my profile. Aaron Moreno, who's in my first class, the very first class I taught in there, had posted up. Actually, he, Aaron, if you're listening, he had done a great job in class. And he comments on just about every time we do a live stream.
Okay. So my name is Natalia Palma, and for my creative presentation, I made the idea of a universal key fob. And the reason I did it was because there was a problem with cluttered keys. People always have a hard time finding their keys, and you can't ever find the one you're looking for. And they're always cluttered. So. So first you have your car key fob, which is usually a fob, but some people just have the key. And then you have your remote for the garage. And the problem with that one is that it always has to stay in your car. And you can't take it with you. So if you ever need to use it, it's never with you. And then you always have your membership cards. Every store you go to gives you a different one. And then you have your gym membership, and they always end up getting damaged. And also you have your front door, which is usually a key, but you can also get a scanner, which eliminates the need for a regular key. So the solution is to incorporate everything into one key fob. And with this device, you can add the key blades. You can also have a different button for everything you need. You could add them. You could program your garage remote, you could program your car alarm. You can also add a sensor for your house key, or just add the regular key blade, as many as you need. And of course, you wouldn't want to lose this wonderful object with everything you own. So as soon as you get it, you would program it to your computer, and you would be able to track the location and disable it if you ever lost the device. And the advantages of this device is that it's small. It would be affordable. It would probably cost as much as a car key fob. It would be easy for anyone to use. As long as you get it programmed, it would come with instructions. And you would get rid of all your clutter. And you can also find it whenever if you lose it using your computer. Thank you.
drinking. Also use the water which we use for showering or for washing our hands. If we filter it and just let it run in the tank of the toilet. I mean, I know it's pretty inconvenient. It's pretty abstract, but it's all the toilet does not care, in my opinion. calculations on it. I don't want to bore you with the numbers, but if a hotel with 500 guests would use this water recycler, it could save $20,000 a year, which is a pretty big incentive. To be fair, just yesterday night I found out that somebody already had this idea, but it does not decrease the value of it in my opinion. Because smart water combining multiple creative solutions to build a system which can save its customer as much water as possible. the last thing, I think we should keep it real here. Innovative water technology is nothing really interesting. It's not the iPhone 7. People don't like to spend time on researching on it or immerse themselves in it. So I think we should need a user-friendly approach for the website, like this. And yes, basically I figured out that business customers are a really important group, because for them it could not only save a lot of money, help the environment, it could also boost their image. So that's pretty much it. Thanks for listening.
How many more people? Let's see, get set up, come on. And your password is? Okay, everybody not look at password. Time to get you another one of those? Is it too late for another caffeine? And need some to eat and move back to the next class, which is a little smaller. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Ellie Hutchinson, and for this assignment I designed a new product called ReFizz. Basically it's the carbonation to any drink. And so I basically thought of a new dissolvable tablet that's like this size, it's white, it pretty much side like compressed into it. So then the concept of this pill or tablet would be to infuse carbon dioxide so you could get the fizzy bubbliness to any drink that you want, like so. You just place it in, and as you can see, all the bubbles fizzing and it's dissolving the carbon dioxide, and you just like stir it around, and then you'd have like instant, like an instantly fizzy bubbly drink. And so pretty much this would be a no calorie product. It doesn't add any sugar or caffeine to your beverage. It's fast and simple and easy. As you can see, it's already almost completely dissolved. It's a pretty affordable and portable. It would come in like a little tube container. And like I said, it's fast and easy. I was thinking that they could each go for like 40 cents approximately, but they would be sold in like packs, so then like eight of the tablets would be $10, or ten tablets for $4, 20 tablets for $8. And then here's just kind of like a picture of like the three steps of how it would look. So for the design thinking aspect of this process, I was thinking for the inspiration, how I thought of this idea was, I was at home, I bought soda, I drank some of it, and then I shoved it in the fridge, and then kind of forgot all about it because it got behind all these other foods. And then when I tried to like have some of it later, like a couple weeks later, the soda was completely like flat. It tasted awful, and I ended up throwing it away. And I was like, what a waste! Like, this is, I'm sure like other people are doing the same thing. So then I asked family members, friends, and other classmates who all like to drink soda or carbonated beverages, like, have you ever had this problem? And they were all like, yes, I have. So then I was empathizing with them. I was like, oh, I know how you feel. I wish there was a way to reinfuse the carbon fizziness that we all love in soda. So then that's how I came up with this a tablet called ReFizz. And so for the ideation, I thought of like, oh, you could do it in a tablet like I chose, or a packet or a pill. And then for the implementation part, I would know I'd want to have research and development to make sure there'd be, get a patent, figure out all the finances, how much carbon dioxide would cost. And of course, I'd want to test out the prototype. And then for innovation wise, it's creative because it's combining concept of a dissolvable tablet that's concentrated in carbon dioxide. And it, since you can add it to any drink, it might change the way people view all beverages. And then for the marketing, I think it's fun and entertaining. I would create a logo and a tagline. Like I said, get a patent, and like I would spread it by word of mouth and social media. And yeah, that's it.
Is that an office? That's really
important. No, it's a bluefish, like pill, like it's like
good demonstration.
How about it? All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Dalton Wilmers, and I'm the creator of HydroPack. So a quick overview of what I'm going to be telling you guys today. First, I'm going to tell you what the product is, how I came up with the idea, and finally, the potential markets I see for it. Okay, so what is it? First of all, it's a backpack for all your shred essentials. So basically water bottles, snacks, maybe small speakers, some surf wax for when you're bored. Starts going away. It's all surfing based. Obviously it needs to be waterproof, so nothing gets soaked inside of it. It's going to be compact, so whenever you're doing turns and everything, it doesn't throw off the weight of the surfer throughout the balance. It's going to be hydrodynamic. One of the ways I went about doing this was, first of all, having this hard exoskeleton you can see up there, all this extra stuff off the front of it, makes the water flow over much more smoothly. And it's also another way, finally, comfortable. The padded straps right there, you can see padded panels help add the comfort for, because you don't want to be able to fill this thing, as well as these buckles up here. I've shifted them from, typically they're in the center of the backpack, I've shifted them to the side so when the surfer's laying down, they don't feel a big pressure on their chest. The final thing I added to this was a life jacket feature. I feel the life jacket feature really adds some safety, because when you're surfing, sometimes you can go out in big days and it just gets really bad. And so the life jacket feature I had is internal bladder, kind of like a camel pack, except instead of filling up with water, it's filled up with air, which would be activated by pulling a tab on the strap, which is connected to CO2, which is connected to the valve, which releases it. Something I had to come up with was the idea of keeping it compact and hydrodynamic, while at the same time allowing to expand whenever you need the life jacket to. And so for that, I came up with the idea of snaps, and something suitcases do is they have like an extra zipper so you can keep it compact, but when you want to unzip it, there's some extra material there that allows it to expand. Kind of a similar thing, except with snaps instead. So for idea generation, I was out surfing with my friend one day, and he was like, it'd be really nice if we had some music. And I was like, you're right. And then we kept talking, we're like, what if we had some snacks, what if we had some drinks? So eventually we were like, thinking of all the problems with surfing, hydrated, you get sunburned. What's your music? You might want to eat an apple while surfing. And then so that led me to brainstorming. Lots of stuff in here that I'll cut out for you. But basically, I brainstormed, looked up all my ideas, about half of them were already done. And so from there, I figured out which ones were actually viable, and from there, which ones I was actually passionate about, something that I actually care about. The intended market would be obviously surfers is what this is designed around. However, I see this can go past. Like GoPro does, into more expanded. And that's it. Any questions?
I want to thank everybody for the hard work and effort that they put into this. What I want you to do is reflect on this a little bit, right? So this link is on my, this is available now on the YouTube channel. I'll shut this one down. It'll be done when you watch it. Go back and watch your presentation. And I want you to score yourself, right? Using the same rubric, right? Because I'm going to give you mine and Ray's presentation. I want to compare it to your score on your presentation, and we're going to talk about those. Your scores will be posted up probably no later than tomorrow morning. Yeah, so let's do it while it's all fresh in our head, and let's have a dialogue. If for some reason you do not like the score that Ray and I gave, right, send me an email, said, KP, I'd like to challenge you on the scoring, and we'll talk about it. But you have to send me that email with your score in it already, right, after you see my score, right? So I want us to be able to have a dialogue. I want you to learn from this, but having this recorded, gives us both a very objective recollection of what you really did up here, because it tends to be very different in your mind than actually what it did. Congratulations on great work, guys. We'll see you next week.